Welcome back to today's session. I think over the last two sessions, we have discussed the structure of financial services. We have looked at the industry as it is in the country, and compared to the global industry of financial services. We've looked at the regulatory framework. We've looked at the environment actually surrounding financial services provision or financial services market. I think today we're looking at the consumer decision processes in financial services. Typically, how do consumers actually take decisions in purchasing or consuming financial product? And it's very crucial because, as we have seen, the financial market or the financial services market is very complicated. And as a result, consumers find it difficult unbundling, the services. And again, as players in the industry, i.e. as financial services expert or financial services marketers, you've got to understand the complications that comes with consumers' understanding of the product and services, and also the processes that the consumers go through in making decisions towards choosing a particular financial product or services. So that's what we're going to look at. So if you look at a session overview, it says in this session, we shall look at the stages in the consumer decision making and the factors and the major players that influence these stages and their roles. We shall also look at the differences in business to consumer and business to business consumer decision making process in financial services. Session outline. The key topics to be covered in the sessions as follows. What is a financial product? Example of financial product, term life insurance, rational consumers decision making processes, and then decision processes for two different types of financial services. Behavioral finance and evidence on irrational consumer decisions. So these are some of the things that we're going to look at. All right, reading list as usual. Okay, so typically what is a financial product? Now, we all know that the financial institutions are intermediary players. They come in to sort of aggregate finances, or aggregate money or money items, monetary items from one person or from one client and then pass it on to another client, i.e. the one who has money is actually sent to the bank or the financial institutions, and then they in turn pass it on to the one who needs it. So financial product is any monetary or any kind of services that gives relief in terms of financial relief or anything that has to do with money as a service to the one who actually requires it. So we have mortgages as financial product, we have stocks, bonds as financial product, and typically we have banking services, credit cards, and all these as financial product. Now, we can see throughout this diagram that financial product always has an input. So the input, which is the sum of money or a sum of or an amount of a particular, item in monetary value. So it always has a time frame within which it has to mature. That is a time frame within which it has to either pay back, mature, it has to, have a particular value, or, not to have a particular value. And then we have the risks attached to it. So in terms of assessing or your assessment of financial services, we have the input, which is the value. We have the time frame within which that value is supposed to mature. And then we have the risk, the calculation of the risk aspect, because it deals with a period, it deals with time period. So we have to calculate the risk aspect as well. And then of course, at the maturity, it comes with an output. So you can see that typical, you know, term life insurance, for example, you have a premium that you pay, which is a yearly basis or per year. You have the length of the policy, for example, 20 years. You have the health risks, for example, are you a smoker? Are you a what you call fast car driver and that type of thing? Or are you involved in some kind of, you know, particular lifestyle, you know, activity that can pose particular risks? And then at the maturity stage, you're actually giving out a payout in case of death, for example. So this is a typical financial product. Now, if you look at it, also you have monthly payments, for example, mortgage. You have term of your mortgage, 30 years. You have credit profile, i.e. we've got to assess your risks level. Are you credit worthy? Do you kind of have other debts that you're servicing, and all those things have to be taken into consideration into what we call, you know, the credit profile. And then at the end, the total mortgage amount is calculated as a value of $250,000, for example. So we can see quite a number of products that are financial, you know, or can be called financial products: auto insurance, home mortgage, mutual funds, certificate of deposit, money transfers, up until policy coverage for mortgage amount, investment. All these are actually financial products. Now, when it comes to financial services, we sort of aggregate, or we sort of put the consumer behavior into two categories, you know, largely. We have the rational and the irrational consumer behavior. And I think it cuts across as well, not only in financial services, but in consumer behavior generally. We have that as a rational consumer decision model and then irrational consumer decision model. Now, if you look at the processes for rational consumer decision, we have always said that in marketing, it begins with a need. It begins with a need. So the individual actually finds out that there is a need that they need to fulfill. Or some kind of a hint of something that they require. You know, so once that need is recognized, we say that that's the first stage. And in marketing, we always say that that need could be recognized inherently by the consumer, or it could be influenced by marketing activities, because we know that there are times where consumers may not necessarily know exactly what they need, which means that need could be latent. And if it's latent, and it means that, you know, marketing activities can actually spur up that particular need for the consumer to realize that, you know, they have a need. So we say that the need recognition is the first stage when it comes to financial services as well. Now, once that person recognizes the need, it moves to the next stage of finding out where to satisfy, where can they get satisfaction, you know, to that particular need, and information on how much would it cost them, you know, and what are the alternatives, you know, solutions to that particular need. So the consumer moves from the need recognition to information search, and then they would be, you know, searching for that particular solutions from various sources. One of them, we can say that word of mouth. So the consumer would be calling friends and relations to ask them that, oh, I'm really in need of this particular thing. Where can I have it? You know, how much did it cost you when you first, you know, encountered it? Or do you have that particular need as well? Or have you had that particular need? So the person start calling around friends and relations, especially most of the time, because we tend to believe more of people who are close to us. So the person starts searching, or they go to the internet. These days, that's the easiest, especially when it's night or you don't want to bother people, or it's about a need that you don't want people to know, you know, because of the personal nature of it. People jump straight away onto the computer. You know, they go to the website and try to key in information, especially when it comes to financial you know, product. It's very personal to a lot of people. People actually shy away from friends and relations to know that they're in a particular, you know, position where they require financial assistance. They may not easily, you know, kind of ask people, you know, about that. So the computer could be the most, the best source for them to say, if I need a loan of 100,000, who would be my best bet? How much is going to be, is it going to cost me? So they resort to computer, you know, they resort to the internet to get some information. Others would go straight onto the company's website because they may know maybe Stanchart, you know, Barclays, Zenith Bank, you know, First Capital Plus, UBA. You know, they will search individual companies and see what they have offer, what they have to offer. Or they may decide to go alternative, not the central banks, but not the major banks, but they may decide to go, let's say, what we call rural banks or microfinance to look at what they have. Others may resort to brochures. They may have come across some brochures, or somebody must have passed on some brochures to them. So there are varied sources of information, you know, that financial people or people, what we call financial services consumers, would go, you know, to look out for information. Then, of course, the person moves to the next stage, which is pre-purchase evaluation. So they've got to evaluate whether, you know, this particular offer that they're going to go in for would be beneficial to them or will be of value. Now, pre-purchase evaluation could mean many things. You know, they could actually have seen, you know, what do you call, endorsement from other people who have, you know, purchased a particular product. They would do comparisons to say, okay, instead of going for a loan, how much would it cost me to go for this money from a friend or from a family? You understand? So they would do these pre-purchase evaluations. Now, would it be better for me to hang on with a loan and maybe go and do some, you know, jobs that could quickly, you know, let me raise this particular money? So they would do all these evaluations, you know, in terms of the time that they're putting in, the cost aspect that is going to cost them in return for the benefit that they get. So they would do these evaluations. Before they, you know, after these evaluations, they move in to do the purchase, you know, that is approach a bank, approach a financial institution and say, well, I require this assistance. And then they go ahead. But prior to this, they have done all these, you know, that's the rational consumer decision making. They've done all these processes. Now, let us understand that these processes are not mutually exclusive. They are not just stage by stage. Sometimes the purchase, pre-purchase evaluation may even come at a point that they're doing information search. So it doesn't mean that you have to sequentially go through this, but again, you know, they may mix it up. Even it can happen the same day as they're actually doing, you know, the processes. So they go into purchase, and once they purchase, consumption. Now, consumption means that they've gone in there, signed the agreement, and start applying the money to what, you know, they were meant to. So if it's supposed to kind of boost their work or their business, they apply it. If they have to buy new raw materials, they apply it, which means consumption is taking place, right? And after that, we say the post-purchase evaluation. So once consumption has started taking place, the person start do the analysis. Is this actually yielding benefits? Okay, you have interest of about 10%, you know, slapped on this loan. How much are you getting back when you started applying it to the business? Is the return, you know, commensurate to the, what do you call, to the amount of money or the percentage of interest on the loan? Now, remember, it is crucial that marketers or experts or, you know, professionals in financial services pay attention to this particular place, the post-purchase, you know, evaluation. Most of the times, we are not, you know, we don't pay attention to that because you think that the sale has gone through. That's all right. But relationship tells us that you've got to be calling the customer to find out whether they are getting the most benefit that they thought or they expected from the product, and what else can you do to enhance that, you know, that thing? So it is not, it is well and good to say, yes, you've secured a loan deal, but it's not the best to stay out. You want to call your customer, your client, to find out whether they're putting it or yielded. If there's anything that you can do, for example, do you know of a source that you can recommend to them that they can uptake your client's business so that they would quickly realize, you know, and pay back the loan, because you face delinquency if the person is not able to. And then post-purchase evaluation is also crucial, because when people experience cognitive dissonance, now extensively they will start buff-muffing the product. Extensively they will start regretting. And once they start regretting, it means that subsequently you're not going to get their business in large part. And not only that, but they're going to recommend to people that if you need assistance, I don't think a loan is the best to do or best way to go. Go something else or do something else. Then you're going to suffer in terms of, you know, sustainability of your clients, or in terms of expanding your client base, or in terms of loyalty and retention. So I think it is very, very crucial that post-purchase evaluation is taken seriously, so that you can build the confidence of the consumer to say, you've made the best move, you've made the best purchase. We are here not only interested in, you know, our sales that we're going to make, but we're interested in your benefit, and we'll make sure that the product, you know, gets you the best. So it is crucial to actually look at post-purchase evaluation and how best you can actually help the client. Now, this again tells us about the decision process for two different types of financial services. So you can see check account, you can see mutual fund. And the stages, as we have described, from need recognition to post-purchase evaluation could be applied here. And then you can see how they either differ or resemble each other in terms of the processes that we have actually explained earlier on. Okay, so we're saying that in financial services, when it comes to consumer, you know, decision making, we have behavioral, you know, finance and evidence on irrational consumer decisions. We're saying that it is not only the rational approach that is available. Consumers can also take certain irrational, you know, approach to consumption of financial product. You wouldn't understand it, but it has some value to them. For example, you have Christmas clubs pay no interest to depositors, yet customers deposit money each week but could only withdraw the money on December 1st. They don't pay any interest in it, but people are ready to put in the money and then cash it on December 1st. Why? Because we know that in traditional wise, I mean, when we're kids, we used to have money boxes, and every day you put in your coins in there in anticipation that come Christmas, you have something, you know, to buy, you know, something that you can use to buy yourself and things. Because the tendency is that, you see, you may devalue the small contributions that you're making, but in the end, it becomes so big that you can apply it to something meaningful. So people take this action. One, because it's offering them the opportunity to save towards Christmas, which otherwise they may not do, you know. So by the Christmas time, they can have some money and buy for exactly the purposes, you know, that the contribution is meant for. So the interest here, or the value here that they gain, is not because of the interest that, you know, otherwise you could be paid in other product, but it's because they are getting the opportunity to make something available, you know, for Christmas purchases. So that's the value that they gain, that opportunity to make something available. And then also, if you look at it, the use of debit cards has surpassed the use of credit cards, you know. Obviously, in our environment, like we discussed earlier on in the previous sessions, Ghana is not, you know, much more credit-oriented kind of market. But elsewhere globally, we know that the debt, that individual debt or personal debt that people are accumulating, is actually increasingly going higher and higher. People are getting into debt, and it makes it difficult for them to do what? To access other products, which in later life would, you know, be necessary for them or they will require. As a result of that, quite a lot of people are actually cutting down on the use of credit cards, and they rather prefer to use, you know, their own funds or their own money that they've actually generated from time to time. Now, in our case, like I said, the credit culture is not predominant in Ghana, and as a result, it doesn't actually show up. But in other sectors, I mean, even if you look at the mortgage market, still people prefer, or the housing market, still people prefer to build by their own, you know, gradually, than sourcing for money to buy some of these houses. Now, consumers use overdraft line of credit on check accounts despite a large savings account balance. What we're saying is that increasingly also in the global market, as in most of the time the Western market, increasingly what we're saying is that although people have large savings account, they prefer to use overdraft. Why? Because obviously savings account is for savings and they get interest on it. Now, the point is that should you be in difficulty, you know, people want to be guaranteed, you know, solvency. People want to be guaranteed cash flows, you know, liquid. Now, if they have to use a savings account, you know, then of course they're actually eating out their future assurance, you know, their future safety nets. Now, they will look at the, how much the company or the bank would charge them in terms of overdraft. That when you go overdrawn in your current account, you know, when you go overdrawn in your current account, it's an arranged overdraft. You know, you actually charge a particular percentage. If it's not arranged overdraft, then of course the percentage charge, interest charge is higher. So they will compare how much interest, you know, is on the arranged overdraft and then think that, well, it makes sense for me to pay just this bit for using an overdraft, arranged overdraft, than chopping off or eating away my savings. Because as you eat away your savings, you're also not getting interest on it, you know. And then just in times of crisis, what happens? You don't have any buffer to support you. So increasingly you see that people, although they may have large savings account, that large savings account will be attracting them interest, which they think they can offset it, you know, if they have to spend on the arranged overdraft, you know, rather than eating out their savings account. That could be a problem for them in terms of solvency. So quite a lot of people are now, you know, falling on arranged overdraft, and then, you know, although they have savings accounts sitting there. People are under investing into their retirement funds. Increasingly, we have also seen that most people are under investing into their retirement funds. Usually retirement funds is a little bit of money that people put away, you know, to guarantee them brighter future, just in case they are out of work or when they retire, they can fall on it. What we're seeing is that increasingly people are actually under investing in it. One, because of the value that they think they can have now. You know, some people are of the view that, well, who knows, let me just, you know, take the benefits that today offer, and as opposed to looking into the future. What if there's no future, you know? So these are some of the things that, you know, is happening. But crucially also, we see that people, especially in our country now, would rather want to be safeguarded in terms of housing. So instead of pushing some money away for retirement, they think housing could be the best retirement package. So they rather use the money to build, you know, their own house, and then they know that they are guaranteed in their own house, other than, you know, living, you know, in somebody's house and with, you know, rents going up and up almost every day, you know, literally. They rather want to secure themselves in future by owning their own, what do you call, housing. So it makes it that instead of they contributing or putting some money into retirement fund, they rather want to use it for something else that can offer value today or even tomorrow, you know. Yeah. And then we have credit card companies' growing use of penalty fees rather than interest charges as a source of revenue. Now, again, that's not actually, you know, predominant in our country because, like we said, the credit culture is not here. But in the West or globally, it looks like, yes, people, credit companies would rather want people to pay penalty fees because the interest that they charge on the card is not that substantial. Well, but you see, that's not the case. The point is that when you charge high interest, people will resist it. But when people have used the card beyond what has been arranged, they will take the responsibility. You know, they will say, yeah, of course, it was my making. You know, I spent more than what I'm supposed to do and things. So they're prepared to pay the penalties, no matter what it is. You know, not too much, but I mean, the reasonable penalty, it's fair. So they will see fairness in that. Rather than you increasing your interest rate, they will think that you're just, you know, taking advantage, or you just want to make undue profit. So that will push them off. So you can actually offer, or companies will actually offer, very low interest rate, but make sure that they push everything else to penalty charges, because the consumer is ready to accept responsibilities for, you know, going over the arranged, you know, about spending more than they're not supposed to, or paying late, you know. So if they have to pay by 10th of the month, and they pay by 2nd, or they pay by 12th or 14th or 15th, they would accept responsibility for paying late, and therefore they would be prepared to pay penalty charges, you know, than you increasing your interest rate. So, rational consumer. All steps in the decision process, need recognition, post-purchase evaluation, do take place rationally. Consumers are well informed about product attributes and competitive offers. Consumers undertake sufficient information search to learn about their options efficiently. So we're saying that for the rational, you know, consumers, we assume, will go through these processes, would find out about alternatives, will find out about the benefits, will find out about what the product, you know, offer them, you know, vis-a-vis the contribution or the effort they are putting in. They find out about all these, you know, who is ready to offer me at this particular charge or whatever, and then they make the decision. So that's the rational consumer. And then again, consumer assessment of risk reflects true probabilities of event occurrence, insurance premium probability times claim amount. Consumers are able to do math, and, you know, for example, the currency is the currency, or a dollar is a dollar, regardless of where it comes from. You know, that's the rational position of consumers. Now, what we have realized is that when it comes to, you know, consumer decision making, we as human beings have certain limitations, and as a result, we are likely to use certain shortcuts or shortcodes or certain cues to arrive at a decision. So we say the sources of heuristics. Now, heuristics are, you know, means or processes through which we come to know something, you know, using a very, some kind of shortcut techniques, you know, to achieve, you know, that knowledge, or to achieve that particular, or to solve that particular problem. So types of heuristics that consumers would use. And we're saying that because of our limitation, cognitive limitations as human beings, because we don't have the capacity to remember almost everything, you know, so that cognitive limitation means that there are ways that we as human beings come to a conclusion using a particular shortcut methods or cues. So limitations in human cognitive circuitry means that, you know, types of heuristics, people cannot count beyond 7. So we're the magical number 7, or we cannot keep memories of things beyond 7. You know, asymmetric discounting, where we tend to, you know, play down, or we tend to discount, you know, certain benefits or certain losses, you know, within a particular time frame. And the attraction effect that, you know, some of these, you know, discounting actually offer, we have anchoring and adjustment. Now, when it comes to emotions, we have mental budgeting of funds, belief in eventual turnarounds, reversing risk preferences, non-rational escalation of commitment, and insufficient consumer knowledge as a limitation. We have underperformance of information search, poor knowledge of risks, decision arrogance, proxy decision making. So let's look at the details. The effect of limitations in human cognitive circuitry. The first is the magical number 7. The next, we have the hyperbolic discounting, the attraction effect, anchoring and adjustment. So we'll take them one by one. the magical numbers of consumers cannot store more than 7 items in short-term memory. As a result, difficulty in conducting mental arithmetic, difficulty in remembering numbers, example, the number of swim lapses, difficulty in appreciating interactions among product attributes, high monthly payment, number of payments, difficulty in evaluating product with more than 7 attributes. So let's take, for example, here, the interaction among product attributes. Now, you realize that when you're presented with offering, and we're saying that high monthly payment times number of payments. So the company presents you an consumer a choice of you know, different offers. And it says one is a higher premium, but over a very long term period, or high premium over a shorter period. So pay 50 Ghana cedis within what, let's say 12 months. Or pay 20 Ghana cedis within a period of 24 months. Which of these is appealing? Now, we're saying that consumer decision in financial services, consumers are likely to choose the second, because the upfront cost, which is 20, seems much more less for them, seems much more affordable, and therefore they want to go for that option. But that's for 24 months. So if you multiply that 20 times 24 months, how much do you get? And then 50, how much do you get? 480. And then 50 times 12, how much do you get? That is 600. Okay, so, okay, let's use a different example. If you take, let's say, yeah, so 50 times 12 gives you 600. So let's say they present you, let's say 30 cedis for 24 months. 720, yeah. But the assumption is that most people are likely to choose the second because of the upfront cost, you know, because they don't want to commit all their resources into that particular thing. So they rather want to have the one that says pay little or pay less for a longer period than pay this more within a period of 12 months. So that's the assumption of the difficulty in appreciating the interaction among, you know, product attributes. So people would rather want to do that, you know, than that. And we're saying that, again, when it comes to product attributes, there's no need to offer customers beyond 7 attributes because they don't keep count of it, they don't remember it. So if you have, or if you're selling a product, financial product, keep your attributes to very minimum level. And especially the close attribute that you think will be of essential need to the consumer. So you offer 1, 2, 3 attributes and that stays in there. If you offer beyond 7 or 7 or more, then of course the customer, it makes it difficult for them to evaluate how valuable or how beneficial that product is to you in terms of comparing, you know, offers. So it is good to make sure that you sum up your product attributes against competitors in a very short, you know, kind of space, in a very short, you know, form, so that consumers will immediately remember your attributes, and therefore once they can recall it, they may think that yes, I think this is the best option. So whenever you want to actually present a financial product, that is what you have to, you know, take to mind, that consumers, as people, we have challenges, you know, of recognizing things, we have challenges of appreciating things, you know, because of this cognitive, you know, what do you call it, limitation. And as a result, you keep it to the barest minimum. Now, factors in consumer credit products, I think we've discussed, you know, some of these already. So your product type and then your factors in there. Asymmetric discounting. Like we said, yeah, just like the cognitive circuitry limitation, again, people as consumer behavior would want to discount, you know, certain things within a certain period. So for example, if a consumer is offered an apple in a year, and the same consumer is offered two apples in a year and a week, the scenario is, which of these will the consumer, you know, take? And we say that asymmetric discounting means people would always discount, you know, benefits or a larger benefit that comes later and choose the one that is although less, but is sooner. All right. So if you're offering someone a benefit and the benefit in comparison to the second benefit, the first benefit is less, but it will come immediately. Consumers are likely to choose that one than the bigger or the larger benefit that is going to come in some time. And that is the consumer behavior. Why? Because there is an assumption, which we will come to that. There's an assumption of turnarounds. People think situations may change. And that is, you know, obviously predictable, because today circumstances will not be the same as tomorrow. So they rather want to take the sooner the better benefit than to wait for the next time. But in the same circumstances, if the two options are also to come in a later time, but closely related, they may decide to wait for the larger benefit. So in this scenario, we say that Apple in a year, or two apples in a year and a week, you know, which of these would a consumer choose? Scenario two says an apple today, two apples in a week from now. And we say that most people choose option B in scenario one, but choose option A in scenario two. What has changed? Why? Because the second one, an apple today means a bird in hand. You know, you get it just today. The B is two apples in a week from now. A week from now, things can change. Now, the first scenario, all of them have 1 year wait. All right, or beyond for the B, because 1 year wait plus a week. And he thinks, I'm waiting anyway. So why not wait for just a week in order to what? To get the two apples. So they lump the two together because all of them are what? Futuristic, you know. But the second scenario, there's one that immediately you're getting it. There's the other one you've got to wait for a week. So you rather want to take the immediate one. So asymmetric discount actually tells us that when we are offering benefits to customers, we've got to understand that consumers wouldn't actually say, because it offers me more, you know, I would take this decision. They would look at which one offers them immediate, you know, help, you know, which one offers them immediate benefits. And regardless of how it is, how small it is, they rather think that given circumstances, given the environmental circumstances, especially in our country where pricing is not stable, you know, they rather want to go for the immediate offer. So if you're competing product, the one that offers immediate solutions is likely to gain the consumer's attention. You know, and again, if that is the case, if you have got a benefit that is, you know, to be delayed, then you may want to put certain measures in place in order to keep the consumer's what interest, i.e., are you able to stagger the benefit in terms of monthly or weekly payments, you know, so that it doesn't make it difficult for them to think, oh, I've got to wait for all these years before I can get this particular benefit. You've got to find a way to, you know, manage the consumer's interest, you know, to manage the consumer's expectation because of, you know, this issue of, you know, asymmetric discounting. Now, another example of asymmetric discounting is, good news, you have 2,500 tax refund this year. You should receive it in about 6 weeks, but we can pay you 2,400 cash for it now if you want it. So the consumer is likely to go for the 2,400 cash now, as per the examples that we explained earlier on. Why? Because they think this is money in hand. But in actual fact, the implied thing is that the discount rate is 36%. That's quite a lot. Yet, they would want to take the money now. Now, the reasons behind asymmetric discount, which says economic theory states that for a specified time frame, the discount rate applied to each payment must be constant. In practice, consumers use very high discount rates for immediate events and very low discount rate for every distant event. You know, so events that are immediate, they would apply very high discount rate, and those that are, you know, far away or distant, they will apply low even, which means people are likely to downplay any effect that they're gonna have in future, whether it's positive or negative, or it's not here. So they will downplay it. And that actually explains why in our system, for example, even in politics, you see that people would actually go for cash now. You know, the one who is actually offering cash immediately, they would want to take that. And not thinking about the, you know, future implications, because people have that tendency, you know, to actually place premium on the immediate than the later benefit, regardless of the variation in terms of value. Now, high discount rates are used for smaller amounts, you know. So people use high discount rates for smaller amounts and vice versa. Primary reason, lack of self-control and poor willpower. We don't have the willpower to wait, you know. So once we can't wait, you always want to settle in for the one that is immediate. So that's the diagram for, you know, asymmetric discounting function. You see that the time, you know, moves forward, the value declines, you know. Although the value could change, the future value, but, you know, the value declines as we move forward. And I'm sure this one would also be contextual, especially in economies that, you know, as time goes on, things get worse, unlike other places where as time goes on, things get better. You're likely to see the depreciation or the slide even much more deeper, you know, than what you see now. So if you see the year 1, year 2, year 3, up to year 6, the value is here. So year 1, you think that there's a high value, the propensity of it reducing moves faster as the year, you know, wears on. That's the rational consumer. Okay, so who uses, you know, or who suffers from asymmetric discount? Purchase of energy saving appliances undervalued by consumers. So if you are actually in that market, you know, let's say you are a financial institution that's actually supporting, you know, a manufacturer who is into this particular market, energy saving. Know that energy saving by long run is supposed to save the consumer money, but they are most likely to be discounted. So the person asks you, which one is this? Okay, energy star, 4 or 3 star rated energy. Which one is this? This one is a 3 or maybe 1 star rated energy saving, you know? And that one, because it's a 4 star rated energy, maybe it's about, what, 1,000 Ghana. This one is about 500 Ghana. Never think that a consumer will go for the 5 or 4 star energy rating, because he's looking at the front loading, he's looking at the upfront cost, and is likely to buy. So you may want to bring a policy where you can perhaps stagger the payment for the energy rating one, because if you leave it as it is with the front loading, consumers may choose the other one. So are you able to stagger the payment to make the payment much more flexible in order that they would actually accept or purchase that particular energy rating, you know, one. Now, most individuals undersave for retirement, we've talked about it, because of the value they think they can gain with the same amount of money being invested. And then the average household has approximately 10,000 of revolving credit and fixed payment loans, excluding mortgage obligations. Well, we've actually talked about this as well. All right. The attraction effect. So we also say that there are ways that financial products are sold to consumers because of the challenges that we have discussed, how consumers perceive or they make some of these, you know, purchase decisions. And we're saying that, for example, an insurance broker presents to you 2 different auto insurance policies provided by 2 well-known insurance companies. See, policy A has 1,275 and liability coverage is 150,000. Policy B has 1,569 annual payment, that is premium that you're paying, and then the liability coverage is 200,000. Now, he goes on to present to you three well-known, you know, policies as well. C is 1,725. It gives you, what, 160,000. Policy D, 1,275, gives you 150. And then policy E, 1,569, gives you 200,000. Now, what do you see? There's a resemblance here, isn't it? Policy AB has been repeated. Has been repeated in what? Policy D and E. All right. Because 1,275 to 150, and then 1,569 to 200. Oh, sorry. To 200. So you can see that A and B had been repeated in D and E. Now, what we're saying is, in financial services, is like what the popular kind of thing in politics that says, you know, propaganda repeated several times becomes truth. What we're saying is that when a particular variable has been introduced on several occasions, or a particular offer predominates other choices, consumers take it to be the best one. So by the time that they see that one particular offer is predominant in the rest of the choices, or the rest of the offer is given, they will think, oh, I think that's the best one then, because it keeps repeating itself. All right. So this is kind of the behavior, you know, consumer behaviors that we know. So as a result of that, you see that C and E have been repeated, as A and B has been repeated in C and E. And so people take it as the best choice. So you have definition for attraction effect. The attractiveness of an option increases when new options dominated by that option are introduced to the set of choices you have. So that particular option is dominated the new options. And as a result, people think that is the best. So agent brokers showing substandard options to prospective buyers with the intention to bias their choices, you know. But of course, that could be illegal, you know, because then you've misled, you know. But that's how, you know, the choices influencing consumer decision, you know, could take. Anchoring an adjustment. Again, we're saying that, and you can see it from the first. You see, the first introduction, the consumer had these two A and B, and they became the anchor. They became the benchmark based on which they were assessing their choice. So when they kept being repeated, then they said, okay, I think that's the one. And anchoring adjustment is like that. What we're saying is that in financial services or in consumer behavior, the consumer always has a pre-knowledge, or always use a preset in an item as the anchor, or as the benchmark, and assess almost every remaining offer, you know, based on that particular benchmark. They only adjust it, you know, if they would actually make any alteration to it. They only adjust it, you know, at a time. So it says investors use purchase price of the stock, that is the price they had paid, to assess their sell decisions. Investors revisit the price of a sold stock after they've sold it to evaluate their own decision. You see, so they bought it at this price, 50 Ghana. Now, when they want to sell it, they're not looking at the future price, but they look at how much they bought it. So, oh, I bought it 50 Ghana. There's no way I'm going to sell it for 50 Ghana, you know, because I bought it for 50 Ghana. So they think that, okay, give me 1,700 or whatever, you know, because they bought it. But in actual fact, they could probably get about 150. But because the 50 Ghana that they bought it is serving as the anchor, they would actually make an adjustment of, let's say, plus or minus 20%, or plus 20% as a base, you know, as a, the adjustment that they would actually add to the base. So most consumers evaluate auto leases by simply looking at the monthly payment, for example, you know. So how much are they paying? Like we saw it in previous example about the insurance. You see, so the person is presented with two offers. How much you're paying monthly over the number of period. They will not even look at the number of period that they're gonna actually use to pay back, but they want to look at the monthly payment. So 5,000 Ghana or 50 Ghana a month for 12 months, or 30 Ghana a month for 24 months. and they will think the 50 Ghana one is too big or it's too huge, you know, too expensive. So they will go for the 30 Ghana one. But in actual fact, over a period of time, the 30 Ghana one becomes dearer. But they won't see it that way. The most popular portfolio mix for university professors' retirement plan is 50 bonds, 50 stocks. Studies show that most professors do not change this mix even as they age and their life circumstances change, because that has been the practice. All right. So they think, oh, it's been offered value. So they keep changing. Bond is supposed to be a fixed amount borrowed by maybe an institution or government, and they pay you what interest on it. So let's say every 6 months they pay you an interest. Over a period of time, they will pay you back your main money. Stocks is ownership. You know, you own a particular amount of money in a company. When the company makes profits and declare dividends, that's when they pay you. Now, circumstances may change. Maybe the stocks are going down, you know, so maybe you want to move, you know, part of your 50% stocks onto your bond, because you know that the bond every 6 months, but they won't do that because it had served a purpose in the past. They've had value in it and things, so they will keep on changing. Or you may want to swap. Maybe the company is making more gains now, the company is making more money, so they may want to, you know, what do you call, divide your bond into two, maybe 25% extra onto your stocks, and then keep the bond to 25%. They won't do that. They will keep under because, you know, it had performed previously. So these are some of the behaviors that consumers actually exhibit. So we're saying that anchoring and adjustment is used to evaluate an offer. Consumers use a reference point to inform, to form an initial judgment or opinion, and then adjust their judgment based on additional pieces of information. All right, so they use a reference point to form an initial judgment, which is the anchor, and then adjust their judgment based on additional pieces of information as they go on. Typically, the initial reference point dominates and the subsequent adjustment is insufficient, you know, because it becomes the initial reference point is all that they can see. You know, even if they are ready to tweak, they don't want to tweak that much, you know. Who uses anchoring and adjustment? Real estate agents. Let's look at some nice homes first, and then we'll see what you can afford. So they will take you to a very nice, beautiful home to have a look. It becomes your standard bearer. It becomes your, so you're fixed on that one. And then they will introduce others. Now, once they do that, of course, you don't know the price about this one, but they're able to, what, influence you. So that at least that becomes the passion. You really want this one, you know. Then before they take you to the, you know, the more rubbish ones, you know, to have a look at them. And then you are so much, you know, into this, you know, kitchen, and it looks fantastic, and, you know. So they'll do that so that they can actually pin you there. They can actually tie you to the offering before you can see, you know, the rest of it. And that way they have actually aroused your interest, you know, in the deal. And then without, you know, barely even thinking about how much it's gonna cost you. And that's why most people wouldn't even talk about price. You know, before somebody tells you something, they will start telling you all the benefits, and you say, how much is it? So don't worry, let me tell you, you know, what you get from this. So they will preach you all the best benefits that you can get in the product without necessarily talking about price, hoping that by the time they come to price, you've been, what, won over, and then the price becomes meaningless, because then your anchoring, you know, is actually on the benefits and things like that. And then, of course, supplementary charges on closing of mortgage contracts are typically not the first item mentioned to home buyers. They will never tell you, you know. So if they're selling your home, they will tell you everything else. All these supplementary, you know, charges, they won't tell you until later, before you come and know that, well, you've got to pay this, you've got to pay that, and things like that. Automobile leases emphasizing low monthly payment more than the high frequency of payments, like we said. You know, they always tell you about the low, oh, don't worry, it's only, what, 99 cedis a month. Then before you realize it's 60 months, you know. So it's always like that. Effect of emotions. We're saying that, yes, we also have, you know, limitations in terms of, you know, emotions as humans. And so people do mental budgeting, beliefs in eventual turnarounds, and then non-rational escalation of commitment, overconfidence. So we're saying that whenever customers are actually presented with offer, the mental calculate, you know, they start working out, you know, what the benefits are in respect to the effort that they're going to put in. So there's always that mental, you know, budgeting that people do. There's always that mental budgeting. You know, how much is my monthly payment and how much am I going to commit on today? They start doing the maths in there. And then, of course, you know what the benefit or what the result is going to be. So you always want to do some kind of influencing, you know, before they use their judgment, their maths to tell them. You want to make sure that you present the scenario clear to them. You want to make sure that you take the step further before they do the mental budgeting. You know, so are you able to articulate, you know, the benefits much quicker and in a way that, you know, their mental budgeting wouldn't actually overshadow, you know, the benefit that they get. So, for example, John recently filed his taxes and found that he has 3,700 of tax returns awaiting him. He was also anticipating, he was only anticipating 1,200. So you see, so once he did the tax returns, he realized that he's getting 3,700. But initially he was anticipating 1,200. John decided to use the remaining 2,500 to buy himself a small scooter just to have fun. Prior to this point, he never had any plans for making such purchase, given his outstanding student loans and credit card debt. See, so quickly enough, he thinks about what he can actually get from the excess or from the windfall. Daily expenditures, people do mental accounts, daily expenditures, yearly expenditures, and windfalls. Each expenditure is associated with one type of mental account, and price sensitivities are lower for shorter term accounts. So people don't really become price sensitive, you know, and they don't actually think about the price if the, you know, the account is a short term business, especially looking at the fact that it's a windfall, you know, they think that they can actually spend it. Now, who uses mental accounting? Especially companies that offer, that actually, or institutions that work on humanitarian, or institutions that, or companies that sell consumables, for example. You know, it is not highly involved purchases, and so they think that, you know, they can use certain phrases to make sure that people quickly would avail themselves. So we say that for the price of a cup of coffee, save the life of a third world child. You know, so immediately you do the mental math in your head and you think, oh, a price of coffee is just about 20p. And if that 20p can save somebody's life, why not? You know, so they will do that, you know, that calculation and say, oh, a cup of coffee, you can drink about three of them and, you know. So NGOs, especially non-governmental organizations, would use that a lot, you know, do the math. But then when you actually calculate, you realize that at the end of the period, it's quite substantial, you know. Yeah, so for less than 50 cents a day, you too can have term life insurance, you know. So 50 cents, not that much to pay, you know. But you see, the fact is that 50 cents a day times 365 days, quite a lot of money, you know. So the person, the upfront, because the upfront cost is too low, you know, the person is ready to do it, to push it in. And he's going to have a term life insurance, you know, for just 50 cents a day. For the price of three cups of coffee, you too can lease the truck of your dream. So three cups of coffee. So if I can forgo three cups of coffee and every day use that money to contribute, you're going to have that, you know. So you there are many ways of influencing in a consumer's decisions, especially to make a purchase that the upfront cost will be too huge. You know, you can spread it in a way that it makes it cheaper for people. So if you have to sell data bundle, or if you have to sell, let's say, no, if you have to sell, let's say, what do you call, a loan, you know, for someone, and the repayment is about, let's say 1,000 Ghana cedis, you know, a month. Now you stand a chance to gain a customer's attention by spreading that 1,000 over maybe 30 days and say that pay just 2 cedis or whatever amount, you know, whatever amount it comes out with. And then the customer thinks, oh, that's reasonable. You know, because immediately he does the math and say, oh, for 2 Ghana I can pay it even with my, you know, 50 Ghana wages that I'm taking. If I take 2 Ghana out of it, it's not that much. But once you say 1,000 a month, the person goes scared, you know, because perhaps it takes a lot to raise 1,000 Ghana. Then maybe every month they go to work, every day they go to work, they can raise that 2 cedis for you. Beliefs in eventual turnaround. This we have also discussed, that consumers always believe that things may change, you know. So we say that Odin, for example, finds that investors have a bias tendency to hold on to stocks that are selling below their purchase price. And they have tendency to hold on to stocks selling below the purchase price, kept losers, sell stocks that are selling above the purchase price, sold winners. In the long run, the sole winners, on average, outperform the kept losers. Well, so he paid 50 Ghana cedis for it. But the stock is selling below the purchase price. He's not going to sell it. He just hold on to it, saying things may get better, you know. So they hold it. And then as soon as those who actually bought it 50 and then see that this stock is actually selling, you know, let's say for 70, he goes ahead to sell it because he thinks that he's gotten, 20 Ghana out of it, you know. But what he don't actually, you know, foresee, or what they don't actually do, is to tie in the benefit to the future of the cost of, the future price of that particular stock. So perhaps if you have held onto it, you could actually get more than that. But because it's selling beyond the price that they have anchored, because they've anchored on what the purchase price, they quickly sell it, they make money. Yeah, they make gains, but they could have actually made more, you know. And then the ones that are actually being kept, also because they know that they have actually bought it at this price and is actually selling, could they have actually sold it anyway to make something rather than still waiting, and then the stock's still tumbling to almost a near collapse? So again, that's the question. So people actually would do that, you know, because of eventual turnaround, thinking things may change. But they don't actually think that things may change for the better or for the worse. You know, it's always maybe for the better. You know, you're thinking things may change for the better. Why investors keep losers and sell winners? Rationally, the reference point, price point used for selling decisions should be future price expectation for the stock. However, investors use their purchase price as the reference point. Selling a loser is like being a loser, you know, so he doesn't want to be a loser, and vice versa. Losses conflict or inflict more emotional pain than gains, of course. Reversing risk preferences. So investment product, option one, deposit 100 in the bank, and option two, 10% chance of getting 1,000, 90% chance of getting zero. So 10% chance of getting 1,000 and a 90% chance of getting zero. Then insurance option, or insurance product, option one, pay 100 to the insurance company, option two, 10% chance of 1,000 loss, or 90% chance of zero loss. Now, most people would choose option one, risk-free option, here for the bank investment product. For the investment product, and choose option two, risky option, for the insurance product. Again, that actually goes back to the examples that we actually, you know, the discounting, you know, what do you call it, asymmetric discounting that we discussed, saying that people would want to reverse, you know, risk, that what, reversing risk preferences, they would want to always look at this, which offers them high risk, which offers them low risk. So they would want to take some of these decisions. And especially when it comes to investment, like the people want to save bet, you know, but it may not be yielding them that much, but still they would want to, you know, do that because, you know, they want to, you know, protect themselves. And some offers may be high gains, but then the risk aspect is higher as well. So they would want to choose. They would want to choose that option. So non-rational escalation of commitment. All right. So we're saying that there is also a point where people commit to particular, you know, kind of product or particular services irrationally. Why? Because of, again, the losses or the anticipation of risks. And we'll see that in this particular, you know, example. You loan $15,000 to a distant friend who was planning to set up a small retail business. Several months later, he approaches you again, stating that he has been experiencing difficulties with his business. However, he tells you that he does have some good news. In particular, he states that if you loan him another $15,000, he would be able to turn the business around and give you all your money back. Alternatively, if you don't loan him the additional money, the business will go down under and you would lose the original loan. What would you do? So again, that is the non-rational escalation of commitment. You've put in 15,000. Now the guy comes and say, give me another 15,000 or everything will go bust. You know, now, as we said about the turnaround, you know, because people anticipate turnaround and he thinks, oh, I'm not going to lose my 15,000. So if you offer me a second opportunity, then I'll commit another 15 so that I can get all my 30,000 back. So believing that things can turn around, they will commit more. You know, what about, you know, committing to lose the first so that you don't get into more trouble? They don't think that way. They think that I surely have to get my money back. So you have to pump in money and then believing that things will change. Again, spending more on an old car you recently repaired. Continuing to wait on the phone for a customer service line to pick up, having waited 10 minutes already. We always do that. You're thinking, oh, they will pick up. They'll pick up. So turn around, you think things will change in the next few seconds. All right. Keeping with a declining stock, we have explained, and continuing with a war considering the large number of casualties so far. You think you will win. Meanwhile, you're losing. So decision makers who commit themselves to a particular course of action have a tendency to make subsequent decisions that continue that commitment beyond the level suggested by rationality. So that's why people would actually, you know, do that. They will continue to do that. And the reasons are that ignoring future potential and focusing on past performance. We always anchor focusing on past performance, ignoring the future potential. And then not appreciating the definition of sunk cost. So too much has been invested to give up. People always, you know, think that. Social and political pressures as another reason, and competitive mentality. Go for it, go for it, go for it. It's always like when you withdraw, you're a loser. So those things will actually keep people to, you know, to keep going. And again, in terms of financial marketing, you know, you always want to believe on that and then be assuring people that, well, the product would work, you know, as a result. Because there's an innate, you know, kind of there's an innate tendency for people to hold on, for example. All right, lack of necessary information. Right, with that, we say that underperformance of information search, poor knowledge of risk, decision, arrogance. Again, that is another, you know, part of the consumer behavior where we're saying that when consumers are actually making, you know, or actually searching for information, you know, on a product, and especially it could be contextual, the information search is actually underperformed, you know, it's actually not done extensively people would want to find one or two search and then they will move on, you know, to the next level. So in the information search phase of the consumer decision process, a minimum number of alternatives should rationally be examined by the consumer, but they won't do that. So for example, if you are actually buying a car, how many have you test drive? You know, do you test drive maybe two or three to know that, yeah, this is the option? But people may test drive the first, and like we said about the anchoring, test drive the first and it's nice, the second, okay, no bother, don't worry, you know, go on, let's go for the first one, you know. And that actually puts us, you know, put consumers in that limited information search thing, they underperform on that one. Typically, consumers do 1/3 the amount of information search they should do or they should carry out. Number of cars driven before purchasing, number of life insurance companies contacted, number of mutual funds considered. So instead of contacting fairly maybe a number of insurance to examine, like we said, you know, the issue about numbering and the issue about what remembering benefits, people would do one or two search and that's it. That means that in competitiveness, if you don't make yourself available to, you know, where the consumers will find you and will be able to do the assessment, you will never get opportunity to be selected, because after one and two, you know, searches and comparisons, they make a decision. So you've got to be sure that your brand or your product is actually number one or is part of those that are being searched, you know, searched on. Otherwise, you don't get to be chosen by consumers. So, and the performance of information search, time limitations, opportunity cost of time. Yeah, because people don't have enough time. So they don't want to be searching and searching and searching. They get one or two, they go, because they're investing time from somewhere to this one, you know. Uninvolving, unexciting choices. Sometimes the act of looking through the choices is unexciting, you know, and it's really boring. Stopping rules used due to declining expected utility of information search. And sometimes too, people think that as more that you search, you become confused and the search information itself loses its relevance. It doesn't make, you know, it doesn't become, you know, what do you call, relevant to you. It loses that utility. So they rather want to search few and then move on with a choice. So value of search and then total true benefit of search. Number of alternatives considered, as you can see. So who uses information search and the performance? One-stop shopping for financial products. So companies who believe or who understand that consumers, you know, in terms of consumer behavior, that is what people do, they under search, they will give you the option. They will say, you know, we're a one-stop shop, come to us, we'll do the legwork for you. Because they know people don't have the time to be doing that. So most of the time, intermediary companies, you know, intermediary companies like the intermediaries that actually serve as, you know, online versions for, let's say, tour companies or tour, you know, firms, will do that for you. Financial brokers or insurance brokers will do that for you. You know, they would actually use it as a basis of advertising to say they have the time, they can do the search, they can compare alternatives, and they can suggest to you the best, you know, out of the alternatives. You know, first-time brokerage, bank, or insurance accounts will do that. So poor knowledge of risk, again, another limitation. Consumers always have poor knowledge of risks. You know, they can't really read in between, into the future, what are some of the economic, you know, risks over there, what are some of the, you know, the environmental risk and things like that. So consumers have a poor knowledge, you know, of that. So low probability events overestimated, high probability events underestimated. We know that the recurrence, events that recur over time, we're almost likely to dismiss them because we're too familiar with them. And those that are rarely occur, that rarely occur because of the media and the hype and things, we tend to what? Overestimate. You know, again, that becomes a problem for us because then people actually are very poor in assessing the risks in an aspect of this. The logic, it won't happen to me. People think that, yes, it may not happen to them. Right? Maybe somebody dies and you think, oh, for you, maybe your families have some few, you know, years or some years to live. So you will not actually take funeral policy. You know, oh, my mom is young, my dad is young, you know. So funeral policy, I don't think is for me, you know, because we don't anticipate it. But it's a high probability. All right, let's see. So uses abuse of consumer lack of risk knowledge, sale of optional auto insurance benefits, policies of fear and of selling catastrophes, consumers' overestimation of risk of catastrophes. Decision arrogance. That is also when we think that people take the decisions and they want to stick by them, because one of the characteristics of, you know, successful people, we think, are people who stand by their decisions. So even when the decision is bad one or it's going wrong, they still want to hold on to it as a firm, you know, people. So we're saying the decision arrogance is also part of a consumer behavior. When people actually take the decision, they stick by it. So individual confidence about their knowledge of fact is higher than their actual knowledge. So people have too much confidence in it, and they don't realize that, in fact, what they know is not up to their confidence level. You know, overconfidence is more evident in moderate and difficult questions and less likely for simple questions. Okay, so there's a suggestion that in 2004, you know, there was a study that shows that when people, if people hadn't actually taken decisions within a particular, you know, period of time, you know, the fund managers, I think they would have made a lot of money. So an example of decision arrogance is actually there. So proxy decision making, recognition of lack of sufficient information in making good financial decisions, reliance on others' decisions as a proxy for what a good financial decision would be. And again, as we saw within the cues, people, because of limitation, they sometimes would use certain short, you know, cues or certain, you know, what we call frames, as a representation of the decision that they make, or they would actually refer to a proxy decision made by someone as a reference point, you know, for their own decisions, all as a result of the things that we have previously discussed, time, you know, what you call opportunity cost of time, asymmetric discounting, and, you know, what you call the anchoring that we have actually discussed. So the case for and against regulations, we're saying that because of all these that we have discussed, the financial services has to have regulation so that they can actually regulate, you know, the way the financial institutions behave, because consumers have limited, you know, knowledge, consumers have limited, you know, opportunity to assess risks. They don't have insight to understand what risks are there the following time. So because of that, regulators have to be there to make sure that, you know, financial institutions don't take advantage of the limited information, the limited knowledge that consumers have. But of course, people would have argument for and against, you know, regulations, as we can see, you know, on the board here. So you have regulation or less regulation. So increased competition, limited deceptive communications, once you regulate. But then when you don't regulate, you regulate or don't regulate, you get increased competition here. And then competition leads to more choices. And then, of course, here. Now, limited deceptive communications, when you regulate, more details on choices, information overflow, heuristics, suboptimal consumer decisions. I think that's the last slide. All right. Thank you for listening. And I think we'll wait for questions again. All right, so question time.
Okay, thank you very much for the very detailed lecture. You talked about poor knowledge of risks, and I've noticed that with equity funds that people invest in, usually customers have a high expectation that they are going to make so much money from little investment, and in the end they end up disappointed because they don't see their monies rising. I want to ask, should financial companies take advantage of this to market their equity stocks to people so that they present it as having very high returns, which is probably not going to happen or is less likely to happen? and in the end customers get disappointed and badmouth the company? Or should they tell customers the truth and have fewer customers coming to them? And again, in the light of the limited cognitive memory of customers, giving them too much information to limit the amount of time they have to process it. So what should financial companies do with respect to this?
Thank you. Well, that's a very, you know, detailed question as well, and a very good one. Well, I think that, yes, from regulatory perspective, I mean, companies or financial institutions are supposed to give customers very transparent, you know, information. They are supposed to be very clear on what it is that the product or the service is actually offering them. Now, most of the times what we have realized, and like we did, you know, see in the time and the opportunity, you know, cost of time, you know, consumers don't really have, should I say, the patience actually to read the small print or to listen to the detailed, you know, information that goes with this, you know, product. And like we said, financial services themselves are complex, and especially when it comes to equity, you know, in the stocks. These are very complex products that customers hardly can understand, which means that, like you said, people get disappointed when the returns don't actually fall within what they thought it would be, which means that the burden is on the financial services to make sure that they make it easily as possible for consumers to appreciate, you know, what this product actually offer. Now, the question of whether you should take advantage and let them have a lot of people coming through, or say to them the truth and have fewer people. We have the concept called quality customers. Now, if you don't come out with the clarity and the transparency that it deserves, you have a lot of customers coming in, but for a short period, like you said, bath-mouthing you, and then the industry suffer. What else will be the future of the industry? A future of industry with no customers. So I think that for them to actually do a good job is for them to be transparent with customers and say, it won't make you millions like the lottery does, but it assures you of financial sustenance. It assures you of, you know, financial safety, or it assures you of, you know, having some money available, you know, and at the tail end, at a very high stage, it can also make you millions. So they have to actually be clear to customers what it is that they are offering, so the customers that they get will be exactly those ones who have interest in actually buying some of these services. And in the end, the industry will gain the reputation that it needs and gradually will win in customers, you know, going forward, rather than staying, you know, with this complexity and actually feasting on the low knowledge of consumers, you know, and then taking advantage of them. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much, Doc. My question is about the difference between industrial decision making and consumer decision making when it comes to financial services. And then the next question is, how would a customer who has no prior experience in any financial services do an effective evaluation? It can be, another option is through maybe word of mouth, but what if the experience of that friend who is going to influence him is not that key in affecting the consumer's decision?
Okay, thank you. That's a good question. Now, with the first one, it comes to the difference between industrial decision making in financial services and consumer. Well, we know that when it comes to industrial product or industrial services, it is about you using that particular services acquisition or that particular purchase to make further business decisions. So therefore, you go for the loan and you know that you are using it to apply to your business as opposed to domestic consumption. So the loan is supposed to, you know, yield some returns as you apply it to the business, you know. So that becomes what industrial, because you are using it in return to service another, you know, business. So you source it here, you apply it to the business, and then you get returns. So if a small-scale industry, or let's say microfinance, for example, is getting a loan from a major bank, that loan is going to be used for another loan portfolio, you know. So they rather want a very low, interest rate, so that they can resell that particular loan to another customer. So they being a customer of a bank and someone being a customer of them as well, you know. So that's a clear difference. One, financial services as a domestic, one financial service as an industrial, where the money is applied to other businesses, you know. Now, when it comes to the second question, that is whether how can a client or a customer of financial service without prior knowledge or without deep knowledge be able to do what? Evaluation, to evaluate the financial product. And that's the more reason why you have, you know, or banks or financial institutions should have personal, you know, bankers or personal relationship, you know, managers. Now, their job is to become the activist or the advocate for the consumer, is to explain into detail the financial product to the consumer. Because even those of us who have higher knowledge in the industry, we're not experts. And we cannot even tell the risks aspect of tomorrow or the risks for tomorrow because of, you know, the rapid or the dynamic change of the environment. So the financial relationship manager is daily, you know, scanning the environment, checking what the impact is going to be the following day. So they have to be able to do a present the product to the consumers so that they will be able to do the evaluation and tell them that, well, when you go for equity, this is what it means. This is the details that actually comes up. When you go for bonds, this is what you get. This is what, when you go for stocks, this is what you get. This, so they become, so to speak, an advocate or, you know, an activist for some sort, for consumer, better services. Now, that enhances the consumer's, you know, what you call interest, and enhances their faith and their confidence in that company, and would see you as not there just to make money out of them or not to feast profit out of them, but there for their interest and for their benefits. I think with that, you will be able to do what? To do the evaluation. And another thing is about giving customers case studies or referring them to endorsers. So maybe a case study of one client hadn't actually borrowed or hadn't actually come to your business and actually succeeded in this. These are very, very effective evaluative tools, case studies, you know, or endorsers. You can even arrange an appointment for this person to go and see that individual that has been a beneficiary, you know, of, you know, your product or services. And that is a huge, huge intro, because that is not actually coming from the horse's own mouth, you know, that is the one that you're serving, but it's coming from, you know, or that's not actually coming from, you know, you, the supplier's own mouth, but it's coming from a horse's own mouth, i.e. someone who had been a beneficiary of the product. And I think that could be a testament, you know, to the new customer that hasn't got an insight in there. So I think that these are kind of ways that you can effectively, you know, do that. All right. Yeah, thank you so much for your attention for this session. I think throughout the session we have seen how consumers behave. We have discussed two clear types of consumer decision making, the rational and then the irrational. And we have said that given the context, consumers will behave differently, you know, towards acquisition or purchase of financial, you know, product. We have seen how, you know, limitations in our cognitive, you know, capacity impact on our decision making. We have seen how consumers would discount, you know, later gains in favor of what you call more immediate ones. We have seen how time and the what you call the opportunity, you know, the opportunity cost of time would actually impact on consumers' decision making going forward. I think these are interesting, you know, kind of concepts that we can carry along in our, you know, strategies, in our, you know, in our tactics when making decisions for financial, you know, services marketing. Thank you once again for coming, and I hope that the next session will be as interesting as this one. Thank you.